Out of the maelstrom of modern war comes the certain knowledge that the force with the better intelligence has the greater chance for victory.
The use of aerial photographs for intelligence had its beginnings in American Civil War days. Reconnaissance pictures were taken of enemy defenses from balloons. Balloons were also used in the Franco-Prussian War to obtain photographs of enemy activity and installations. In World War I, photographs taken from balloons, dirigibles, and specially fitted aircraft were used for intelligence purposes by both sides. The Kaiser's armies were far advanced in aerial photographic work. They published the first manual on the interpretation of photographs.
In 1938, it was General Oberst Baron Werner von Fritsch who prophesied, "The nation with the best photographic intelligence will win the next war."
During World War II, photographic intelligence developed as a spectacular contribution to the field of military intelligence. Both sides equipped high-flying, fast aircraft with special cameras to bring them photographs of enemy defenses, enemy movements, and enemy activities.
Major General Kegler of the Nazi Reichswehr stated the thesis for aerial reconnaissance. Without reconnaissance, command and troops are blind. Reconnaissance without aerial reconnaissance, like aerial reconnaissance without aerial photography, is inconceivable.
But early in the struggle for Europe, the Nazi High Command also recognized the need for officers trained in the field of interpretation of aerial photographs. Unless specially trained personnel were available to screen the photographs, much intelligence could be lost. Schools were established, and young officers selected and given extensive training in interpretation of photographs for intelligence purposes. The Allies, too, established photographic intelligence schools, trained selected personnel in this specialized science. It was the completeness and accuracy of our photographic intelligence which made possible the most effective employment of our troops and our fighter bombers in Europe. From aerial photographs of the volume and direction of enemy movements on rail, road, and water, photographic interpreters were able to supply vital information for the planning staff. Armed reconnaissance routes could be established. Rail and road interdiction strikes planned, troop and vehicle concentrations targeted. Result, the destruction of the German war machine.
The commanding general of our Third Army, General George S. Patton, Jr., said, "Air reconnaissance of the enemy, performed by the 19th Tactical Air Command, has provided the Third Army with timely and accurate information to aid its various and difficult operations."
Operations of this tactical air command were tremendous in August and September of 1944. Planes of the reconnaissance group operated simultaneously at Brest, France, and Frankfurt, Germany.
Separated by more than 500 miles, this group provided photographic coverage on the exposed southern flank of the army and also sought out and located movements of enemy troops which might have threatened our communication line. In speaking of the tremendous value of photo reconnaissance to all units of his command, General Patton said, "Aerial photography provided all commanders with accurate and detailed pictures on which to base intensive studies of enemy defensive installations while planning future operations."
In the Pacific theater, intelligence through photographic reconnaissance accounted for the greater portion of all intelligence received. Reports of the 2nd Task Force operating in Japanese waters from 2 July to 15 August 1945 show how well photographic interpretation served to spot well-camouflaged targets. It had become standard practice in the 2nd Task Force to assign photo planes to the first strikes against airfields.
wise commanders had learned that since a camera can see and record, what a pilot occupied with keeping formation, evading flak, and flying his plane can seldom observe, photographic mission coverage was mandatory. In this attack against the network of Japanese airfields located on the Tokyo Plains, the early morning strikes produced little damage. As the photographs from the morning flights were processed, and the next strike pilots were briefed by individual photos, the number of planes destroyed in the later attacks increased greatly. In the fifth attack on these airfields, 403 planes were destroyed or damaged. The accuracy of this attack may be directly attributed to the effect of photographic intelligence. Each pilot had a picture of his individual target, and he was briefed on the location of his individual target, its camouflage, and the best way to approach the target and to avoid flak. By using these methods of intelligence and attack, in the period of 13 strike days, a total of 1,111 planes were destroyed, and 1,161 were damaged on the ground. At the end of hostilities, the United States was far advanced in the uses and capabilities of photographic intelligence. In the Pacific theater alone, over 250,000 rolls of aerial photographic film were exposed, processed, and translated into military intelligence by experienced photo interpreters. But from the end of the war until the start of the Korean conflict, photographic intelligence as a weapon was allowed to gather dust in the arms closet of the nation. Field commanders, wing commanders, and carrier captains either forgot or did not understand photographic intelligence, its uses, and its capabilities. Photo reconnaissance squadrons and supporting units in the Far East were inexperienced and undermanned. Carrier captains, anxious to hunt the enemy, were loath to launch and escort the stingless, ungunned photo plane. The Army reeling back toward Pusan concentrated on its primary defense problem, that of keeping the 8th Army intact and able to fight. When the services appraised their photographic intelligence capabilities, they found that an acute shortage of trained photographic interpretation personnel existed. Most of the officers trained in photographic interpretation were reserves on inactive duty. Once qualified interpreters were recalled from the reserves and sent into interpretation units established in Korea and augmented in Japan, photographic intelligence gained in effectiveness in the Korean theater. Most of these reserves had grown rusty in PI procedures and techniques. The number of qualified regulars was so pitifully small as to be almost non-effective. PI training was accelerated and refresher courses were conducted. Priority systems could be worked out and target responsibility defined. During the Korean War, thousands of photographic missions were flown by all services. Officers and enlisted men worked around the clock to supply the vital military information needed to stalemate the enemy. The Air Force went up at night to make flash bomb photographs of the enemy, who was forced by our air superiority to move under cover of darkness. From the night photographs, the movement of enemy troops and supplies could be determined. One typical operation was the photographing of every communist or neutral ship entering communist ports in the Yellow Sea or the Sea of Japan. By comparing these photos with others taken of the same ships leaving or entering other ports, the communist supply routes on land and sea, and the number of vessels engaged in supply were discovered. From the photographs, we were also able to determine what general types of cargoes were carried, how much material was being supplied, and if there was a buildup in a communist port. We have judged the effect of photographic intelligence on the wars in our immediate past. To determine the part it should and must play in the future, we must understand something about the equipment needed to obtain aerial photography, the field in which photo interpretation operates, and the men who use it. Aerial photography is produced by many different types of aerial cameras. Each of these cameras is designed to solve a particular problem in aerial photography. Obtaining pictures at night, pictures for maps, for determining depth of water, pictures in scale of 1 to 25,000, or 1 to 5,000, depending on the nature of the mission. These cameras provide two general types of photography. Vertical photography, made with the lens axis of the camera approximately perpendicular to the Earth's surface, and oblique photography, made from any angle other than vertical. The obliques may be termed low or high, depending on the angle the camera makes with the horizontal. The high oblique includes the horizon. High refers to the camera angle and not the altitude. The aerial photograph may be a continuous roll, as in the Sony strip camera, or it may be a series of independent or overlapping single pictures, which form stereo pairs. Each of a pair is a separate picture of the same object, taken with a distance separation. The camera axis is parallel for each exposure, and thus a slightly different view of the same object is given. This is called parallax difference. These pictures are timed so that they overlap 60% along the flight path of the airplane. This gives the viewer of the pictures two different angles on the same subject, and thus enables him to supply the missing dimension, the third dimension to the photograph. By a complex system of measurement and calculation, the photographic interpreter can ascertain the height and width of any object and judge its true shape. This appears to be a peaceful pastoral scene with foliage and terrain similar to that found in North America, as viewed by an artilleryman 1,000 yards away. And here is a pilot's eye view of the same pastoral scene. But with the aid of the stereoscope and specialized training, the photographic interpreter is able to determine the location of hidden gun positions, troop movements, communication installations, and similar activities. Photographic intelligence serves as an accurate, dependable, and comparatively swift source of intelligence information. In contrast to eyewitness reports, it makes a sure and permanent identification record. Eyewitness estimates on the identification, number, and composition of enemy forces may vary in direct proportion to the number of witnesses and the circumstances under which their observations were made. It has often been the intelligence officer's experience to receive conflicting action reports from pilots who have flown in the same element on a mission. Interpreters have learned through evaluating the experiences of two wars that pilots tend to report all mound-like structures as munitions dumps, that any submarine or even a fishing boat is automatically an enemy sub, that any bomb which covers a target with dust is a hit. Photographic intelligence through the use of aerial photographic reconnaissance and modern photographic interpretation is concerned with almost every phase of modern warfare, with transportation and communication, with shipping and shipbuilding, with electronics, hydroelectric power, vegetation and terrain, with industrial subjects, and with urban areas. The utilization and evaluation of photography in warfare has indeed paralleled the rise of the airplane in warfare. Its perfection and capabilities have soared and multiplied with the advance of the aeronautical science. For photographic intelligence is a physical science. And like all physical science, it reaches conclusions through a systematic interpretive study of the evidence brought in focus before it. The conclusions reached are as accurate and as dependable as the equipment, the men who take the pictures, and the men who interpret them. Suppose that sometime in the future, an occasion demands an all-out attack here. The Joint Planning Staff correlates all available information on the target area. Lacking, however, is up-to-the-minute data without which small hope can be held out for success of the attack. Data such as composition of the beach, gradients, location of rocks, reefs, inlets, and man-made obstacles, latest information on tides and currents, location of emplaced shore defenses, mines, guns, and the like. Inland, condition of roads, loads they can carry, portability of streams, location of minefields and supply depots, disposition of enemy forces, air and ground, location of enemy artillery, war potential of the enemy, his munitions plant, his raw materials, his resources, his communications and supply lines. Requests for this detailed information go out to the military services capable of obtaining it, to the Air Force, and to the Naval Air and Submarine Forces. The specially trained photo pilots are briefed by photographic intelligence officers aboard aircraft carriers at the many air bases. Each pilot is told exactly what coverage his own photo mission is expected to provide. Cameras which will take the required vertical and oblique photographs are installed in each photo plane. Each plane crew carefully checks the cameras and automatic camera controls before takeoff. Now the training and experience of the pilots begins to pay off. Not only must the coverage be exactly what was ordered, but the photograph must be correctly exposed to provide optimum definition and clarity. Submarine skippers, too, are briefed on their photo mission. There are no substitutes for photo training and experience as the underwater craft enter hazardous waters and make their dangerous photo runs within range of the enemy's guns. Periscope photographs must be made right the first time. There is seldom opportunity for a repeat run. The exposed film is processed, prints made, and delivered to the photo intelligence unit. Now, photo interpreters search the photographs to find the information and data needed by the planning staff. Information and data now flow through channels to the joint planning staff. As information is correlated, a complete picture of the enemy's potential in the target area unfolds. Plans for attack now can be completed. Targets are selected. Methods of attack determined. Here, photo interpretation permits structural analysis of enemy defenses and buildings and aids in the determination of the most effective weapons to employ against them. Through photo intelligence also, black maps are prepared to help pilots reach their targets as safely as possible. To pinpoint the targets themselves, photo intelligence provides target identification photographs for each pilot. After each attack, it is the intelligence supplied by photo interpreters from aerial photographs which provide the only accurate source of damage assessment.
Good afternoon, Commander.
Good afternoon.
I have the post-strike photography from the Kango airfield. 8 aircraft were destroyed on the field. 2 more aircraft were destroyed when this hangar burned. This hangar burned, and these 2 hangars were destroyed without burning. The field was out of action as a result of severe bombing.
Was all that done today?
Yes, sir. Yesterday's photography showed that only 4 of the hangars were destroyed, and the field was definitely active. These photographs, before and after, show that all the damage was done between yesterday and today.
Information and data supplied by photo interpreters from aerial photographs can lead the way to planning a successful attack anywhere. Photo interpretation is based on exact sciences, education and experience in engineering, geography, geology, and architecture are among the prerequisites of the photo interpreter. Only through training, highly specialized training by qualified instructors, can the science be learned and trained interpreters be made available for this important military duty. Adequate working spaces must also be allocated for this vital work in operating areas. These spaces must be safeguarded from encroachment in peacetime so that they are immediately available for the expanded effort conflict demands. So that we can be prepared for any emergency, any time, this training must go on in time of peace as well as in time of war. Yeah.